Okay, take us away, Dr. Turner.
Well, welcome everyone to this third session on Adopt a Street. Tonight's topic is a global canopy of prayer evangelism, and we're going to talk about how entire cities and states and nations are being adopted in prayer following the model that Jesus introduced to his disciples so long ago in Luke chapter 10, verse 1, where it said, "And Jesus appointed 72 others and sent them out to every town and place where he was about to visit." And then in Luke 13, it says that Jesus actually went and visited all these places that his disciples had prepared for him. So none of our efforts are in vain. So tonight, let's open in prayer by saying, Father God, we do thank you for this opportunity to get together on this global webinar. We thank you for the participants and for the students that are on. We thank you for those who will be listening by recorded session as well. And we just ask, Lord, that you would give us the same burden that you gave to those 72 unnamed disciples so long ago that took the message into the streets and into the homes and prayed for those that none should perish, but that all should have everlasting life. We ask that you'd seal our thoughts and conversations tonight. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Well, thank you, Benji, and thank you, everyone, for joining us. We have two panelists tonight. Number one is Dr. Lisa Fuller-Tweh from Detroit, Michigan. And Lisa's got a great story to tell. She came out to Newark 3 years ago and wanted to learn firsthand about Adopt a Street and Pray for Newark. And what she's done with it from there is truly remarkable in Pray for Detroit. We also have Becky Haas with us as a panelist. Becky will be with us the next three sessions as we talk about Adopt a Cop. And she's done some remarkable work in Johnson City, Tennessee. So please invite your friends to come next time, and I'll be talking next time, and then the time after, I'll turn it over to Becky, and she'll talk about some of her groundbreaking work in Tennessee. And Becky, I understand you've been showing the Newark video all over Tennessee here, so I guess Adopt a Street and Adopt a Cop are cross-pollinating each other, as we would say.
Absolutely. It's such a good visioning tool to use that Newark video.
Okay. All right. So, well, welcome everyone on the call. We'll get started now. And the session topics that I have assigned for us, we talked about how to launch and grow a street adoption initiative last time and how to pray for your adopted streets. We were blessed to have Gordon and Gail Oakley from Lehigh Valley, Pennsylvania to give us practical guidelines on how they pray for their adopted streets. Now, tonight we'll give you some testimonies, particularly from Detroit, Michigan. We'll talk about the global canopy of prayer evangelism. We'll talk about some practical ways that you can apply these concepts in your own area and some food to think about. We'll have some questions and answers. And then at the end, we'll ask Dr. Lisa Fuller-Tweh from Detroit to close us with a prayer and an impartation for street adoption. And then as time permits, I have a number of slides from Indonesia that I'm excited to share with you tonight. Daniel Panji is a good friend of ours. He's not able to be on the call, but he's given us a lot of material, and he's looking for 1 million people in Indonesia to adopt streets. So I know you'll be interested in hearing about that as well. So from last week, I had some questions from Pastor Thomas Robertson in Uruguay, and he got the Street Adopters Handbook as well as my earlier book called Highways of Holiness, which helped to launch the street adoption book as we were in Argentina. And we asked people to pray for highways, and they told us in Resistencia that a highway or a street really has the same meaning in Spanish, that there's two separate words that are similar. So you could pray for either a highway or a street. So his questions, and I'll just touch on these briefly tonight. It says, He can't identify the dried up wells that were from the previous moves of God. And the question is, how would we do this? And what would it mean to dig new wells of revival? Well, this goes back to Genesis 26, where it talks about Isaac redigging the wells that his father had dug and how those had gotten clogged up by the Philistines. Well, the same thing happens in a spiritual sense. We know when a move of God gets extinguished for one reason or another. And we can go back and look at the prayers of people at the time and see which prayers didn't get answered. We can also check news accounts and see what happened from the newspapers or from testimonies of people in those past moves of God that might have dried them up. And then the question about what would digging new wells mean? Well, that could mean that a new church or a new ministry starts up that's breathing life into the old ministry. For example, here in the United States, we have a rich tradition of Salvation Army work. And that, of course, goes back to General William Booth from England, who William and Catherine Booth set up the Salvation Army. And they're breathing new life into it in our cities today as the gospel is spread and services are being given to people that are in need. The next question that he has is, do street names have spiritual significance themselves, which must be dealt with? Well, I guess a street name could be significant. Just like a city name could be significant. You know, in Argentina, that Ed Silvoso and Dave Thompson pointed out that Resistencia means resistance in Spanish. So a town named Resistencia probably has some component of warfare associated with it. And similarly, we have a number of cities in the United States that are called Washington Place or Martin Luther King Place or Christopher Columbus Place. There's historical and probably spiritual significance on those as well. But that you'd have to answer on a case-by-case basis. Now, the third question that Thomas raised is he's covering 100% of his city in Montevideo, Uruguay, which is a Carrasco neighborhood, or Carrasco neighborhood, rather. And he wants to know what's the best way to strategize to prepare to adopt a street. We talked about some of these ideas last time. We talked about setting up quarterly meetings. We talked about prayer rallies. We talked about specific ways of praying for your streets. The question is, what would be relevant for that particular neighborhood? And without knowing a lot about the neighborhood, I don't have any specific suggestions, but I'm sure that Thomas and I can discuss those offline, and I'd be willing to talk with any of you that are listening in the audience as well about how to approach your own neighborhood or city or state. Then he says he has a small group of committed prayer warriors that are 8% of his congregation, and he wants to know how to take it to a higher participation rate. Well, that's just a great question, and we're going to talk about that in our next few slides, so I'll hold that. Number five, how do you recommend we prepare, aside from prayer, a local church for a project such as this? Well, one idea, as we mentioned last time, is to have a church coordinator that works closely with the pastor or pastors to get streets adopted. Typically, the pastor is going to be a very busy person and won't have the time to coordinate all the street adoption work, but a church-wide prayer coordinator that works with your local initiative is a great way to start. And then number six, what teaching or groundwork or building blocks do you think is necessary to make this a church lifestyle? Well, I think the letter, one of the letters to Timothy, that Paul says that we need to model our faith. And I think that's really the key. Just as Jesus modeled being a good shepherd, we need to model being good shepherds to our neighborhood. And we'll see some examples that are practical from Indonesia tonight about how they do that, okay? So those are some quick answers. I appreciate your questions, and I'll try to answer them next time. If you have additional questions, just let me know. Okay, let's move into street adoption testimony. So we have more than 400 cities in the United States now that are involved in the Transform Our World website to do street adoptions. We have the whole state of California through Canopy of Prayer. We have a similar initiative in Hawaii called Hanai a Street, which means to adopt a street. We have about 70 cities in Hawaii that joined that initiative. We helped to launch the Jacksonville Prayer Walking Initiative. And now the sheriff of Duval County has urged people to get every street in Jacksonville adopted for prayer. That's pretty mind-boggling. Jacksonville has about 10,000 streets. It's the largest geographic mass of any city in America, although it's not the largest population-wise. We We have Pray for Detroit, which we'll come back to. And then we have a number of other initiatives. This is one in Dalhart, Texas, in the Panhandle, where they asked me to come out a couple years ago and help them launch their initiative. Okay, so here's the key question for this week, folks, which is, how can we take our Adopt a Street initiative to the state or national level? And let me suggest to you four ways to do that. Number one is, we'll have Lisa talk in a minute about Pray for Detroit and how she got started working with us and what she did with our ideas to take it from a small city of Newark to a larger city, to Detroit. Secondly, I'll give you a couple prayer apps, one of which is called Adopt Your Street app, which if you've been to the Harvest conferences, you've heard about this one. The iPhone version of it is currently available. And there's another one that I just became acquainted with recently called PrayForEveryHome.com, which is an app that you can do either on the smartphone or on your computer. Thirdly, you can check out the Bless Minnesota initiative. And I know Tanya and a pastor from Northfield are on the call here that are part of Bless Minnesota, so they may have some ideas and insights for us there. And then Adopt a Street in Indonesia, which is myhomeindonesia.org, is their web link for their street adoption initiative. So without further ado, I'll turn it over to Dr. Lisa Fuller-Tweh. So Lisa, welcome to the conversation now, and we're glad to have you with us.
Well, thank you. I met Lloyd probably 2013. I was doing a mission trip, and it was for the Hurricane Sandy. And what happened was God had placed in my spirit to just the burden for Detroit. That, and what's really interesting is I'm originally from West Virginia. And I relocated. I've been in Detroit for over 25 years. And God had placed a burden on my heart. My family is in Detroit, multiple family members, multiple generations. And I actually seen the city go from where it was thriving to where there was basically destitute and it was thriving, and then to the point where the businesses and places had left. And God said, you have to do something. You have to do something. And he told me, he says, pray for the city. And what happens is I began and I spoke to someone named Rebecca. And she told me, she says, we're doing the same thing in Newark. And she began to tell me about Lloyd and what's happening. And God put it upon my spirit. And I asked her, can I come to one of the meetings? And she said, sure. I said, well, please ask Lloyd first. And it was amazing because I knew that I was in the right place, and I knew that it was a divine appointment, and it seemed very overwhelming. And I know that when God gives you something and you know it from God, it does seem overwhelming. And so I began to go in prayer, and I asked God for a strategy. How do I cover the cities? And I'm an intercessor, and we build a $23 million church. It was in a recession. We had no land. And every single day we were there, sometimes two and three times a day, praying for the church to be built. Again, we had no land and we had no money. And God opened up resources and he gave us land. And so based on that, what I seen, I knew that he would give me a strategy how to cover the city of Detroit, how to cover the streets. So I began to ask him, and I began to ask him in prayer. And he said to me, the zip codes, and use the same prayer warriors that you've co-labored with for the last 3 years. And so I contacted Lloyd, and they gave me an app, which all the streets and all the zip codes with the streets within the zip codes I had access to. And I prayed and I said, God, you know, give us laborers. And so as a result, what happened was, is that the people were very receptive, and they're committed prayer warriors. And we prayed, and we still do, for every street within a particular zip code. And ownership is so important. So the people who live within the zip code, you know, we prayed for the particular streets. They know what's going on. We know what's going on in the particular streets. We were able to walk the streets. So as a result, the first of every month, we all come together, even people in different states, and we pray for the city of Detroit. And not only that, one of the things that God has shown me recently is that in addition to praying the first of every month from 9 o'clock to 9:30, he said that to have the people who are in the particular zip codes to pray so that there will be unity in different groups of people, hundreds of people praying at the same time. In addition, we've had the opportunity to prayer walk, and we've been very successful, and we learned some of the strategies that were named for the Vallejo group by placing information on doors, telling people, you know, we're in the neighborhood, we want to pray for you, come and visit us. And we've been very successful with that. Because of the winter, we haven't had the opportunity to actually go out, but we're starting up again. And then in addition to that, we're just telling the people, you know, telling them, come and join us. And we've been laboring literally every morning. We pray, a group of us, myself and one of the head intercessors for my ministry, we pray together and on a daily basis. So it's layered, and we're seeing the effects. The city's growing. We see new businesses, vacant homes being torn down. It's just amazing what's happening. The riverfront has been restored. There's new buildings. There are new parking areas. There's money being filled, you know, put into the city. It's just amazing. The downtown is being refurbished. And of course, you hear a lot about the crime, but in the same sense, there is just a wave of glory that's been created and a buzz that's been created in Detroit that's just absolutely amazing. And I give God all the glory for that.
Praise God. So, Lisa, can I pray for you and your team as we wait for people to ask questions I'm sure that some people online have some good questions for you, but let me pray for you first. Father God, I just am amazed at how you speak to people around the world and give them the same ideas and the same thoughts and the same heart that you had when you were here on earth through your son, Jesus. And Lord, I pray for the intercessors and the captains in Pray for Detroit. I thank you for their passion and their burden for the city. And Lord, we want to see greater things happen as we hear hopeful signs of transformation. And we want to give God all the glory for this work in Jesus' name. Amen. So, Benji, I think we can open up to ask if there are questions from the listeners.
Absolutely, yes. If you've got a question, either for Dr. Lloyd or Dr. Lisa there, go ahead and just send us a little note here in the chat box, or if you like, I can promote you to panelists so we can see you and hear you. Just a question, Lloyd, did you want Becky or have her wanting, did you have her wanting to share something tonight?
Becky can enter in the chat box if she wants. I don't think she had anything that she wanted to present this time. She's kind of gearing up for next week. We'll be giving her a lot of questions probably about Adopt-A-Cop next week.
Sounds good.
So Lisa, just to elaborate on your strategy. So you have a big team of intercessors, and you assigned a few intercessors to each zip code. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct. And what has happened is I gave the list of the streets to the intercessors, and it was people who I knew that lived in the neighborhood and the people who I knew that were co-laborers with me. And we had a solid record. And the reason I say that is because of the faith. They believed that, you know, through faith and what we had seen, that God would move and embrace
it. Well,
that
the Vallejo team pioneered with?
Yes, as a matter of fact, we partnered with some of the different churches, and we're taking the concept. So when we went out, as a matter of fact, the last time we went out was in November. So when we went out, we used the door knockers and to let the people know in the community that we were there. And one of the things that we did was we didn't say we're here and from, you know, X amount. We used the community church that we were the neighborhood church. So the neighborhood that we went in and we prayed, we used one of those contact places to ask the people to come in and to pray. And not only that, but we went into the businesses as well.
Wow, that's terrific.
Excellent.
Benji, did you have any questions either from the panel, the participants, or from yourself?
I'm just looking here at the chat box. Question from Tanya just came through. It says, I really appreciate your wording of layering intercession. Do you go out then and meet with the intercessors at other churches, or do you have team members, you release to do that? That's a question for you, Dr. Lisa.
Well, what happens is when we had the community walks, or when we had the community walks, we invite all the intercessors and we invite everyone. I basically duplicated what I saw in Newark. So I had everybody to come. We invited everyone to come and to participate, the intercessors, the pastors, and we all participated. We all walked. As a matter of fact, we had the opportunity to witness. And so each person who was there, as a matter of fact, I believe we had between 5 and 7 churches in November, and it was very cold, and it was just great. It was really great.
Excellent. Very good. And then Lloyd, you had mentioned a couple apps. If you could just repeat that, because it looks like one of the questions is related to that. Maybe pull up the slide that has those two that were listed. That's great. I know there's the newer one you're mentioning about Pray for Every Home.
Yeah. Okay, so here's the Adopt a Street app. It's on transformourworld.org. And if you've been to the conference or you've heard,
Danny Kim.
Danny Kim, thank you. Yeah. Has written this app. He used Pinterest as a starting point, and then he modified it so that you can see every place that people are prayer walking, and then you can actually connect with those people on your prayer walk, which is pretty exciting. And then you can also bring in, you can map local crime statistics. If you want to see where crimes have occurred in the neighborhood, you can prayer walk those pretty much in real time. So that's pretty exciting. And down here it says contact Ken Schuler at 408-513-1470 for additional information about that. So the Android version, I guess, is in progress. I believe they need some funding on that to continue with the Android application of it.
Yeah. Yeah, we're one of the questions is, will Harvest Adopt Pray for Every Home? And that's brand new to us, so it's something we'll definitely take a look at. We're working very closely with Danny Kim to, you know, build out that app that he has as part of that. So the PrayForEveryHome.com, that kind of sounds like that may come from Dick Eastman's ministry. Is that correct, Lloyd?
It's out of Baptist Church in Texas.
Oh, okay.
And I think it's Collins Baptist Church.
Okay.
And I think the name is Pastor Huckabee, Charles Huckabee, maybe.
Okay.
I don't know him personally. He could be part of Dick Eastman's initiative. But I heard about it. Actually, this was an interesting story. I was invited to New York on Friday. And the people in New York are now envisioning how they can get every street in New York City prayed for.
Excellent.
So they invited me to come, and I explained to them that they had already started this 150 years ago, and it was called Systematic Visitation of Households.
Yeah.
So once they discovered that it was in their DNA, they got all excited about it and said they want to apply some new technology about it. So one of the tools they use in Pray for New York, which is a local prayer initiative, is this PrayForEveryHome.com app. And it has something called Praying Neighbor here. So let me just show you a couple slides on it. I haven't actually looked at the app myself, but what it says is that if you log on to the computer version of it, it will give you the names of 100 of your neighbors in a PDF file. And furthermore, if you are involved at the church level, you can get an app on your smartphone so that you can have the computer give you the name of 5 people out of the 100 every day to pray for. Mm-hmm. So every 20 days you would pray for 100 of your neighbors.
Yeah. That's great. I think that's awesome. It's so wonderful to see the tools that are being developed. And I mean, knowing that we can just use our smartphones now to do so many things, but in particular, applying it to street adoption, all that is wonderful. I know that with the Adopt a Street app, like you were saying earlier, Lloyd, it's awesome because you can just consistently track, you can track your prayers. And then it maps it out. It puts it on the map, and almost like a heat map showing you where all the prayer activity is happening.
Right.
That's one of the wonderful features. And then linking it as well to crime statistics is a real plus, I think, as well. So that you can see, hey, this is where we should increase the prayer or target our prayers more specifically, praying for some specific felt needs in the neighborhoods and all of that. So regardless which tool that you want to use, and I certainly encourage you to use the Adopt Your Street one, but get going, just get out there doing the stuff. And I think we see an example of Dr. Lisa here. The Lord put this burden on her heart and she just went for it, and the Lord then supernaturally connected her to others. And, it spread very quickly to the point where we're seeing an incredible city of Detroit being, thoroughly prayed for, which is just exciting. So, and now to hear about New York, Lloyd, that's awesome. That's incredible.
Yeah, the New York effort is just getting started on it. So I told them about, the Adopt Your Street app, which they hadn't heard of, and they're going to check it out. I think there's going to be different tools for different purposes. So the amazing thing about transformourworld.org is you have the whole world online. You can adopt any street in the world.
Yeah.
The amazing thing about the prayer app is that you can see where people are actually prayer walking and what kinds of things are happening in your neighborhood.
Yeah.
And then the amazing thing about the prayforeveryhome.com is, well, let's say you want to go to level two of prayer evangelism. You want to know people on a name basis and eventually develop a relationship with them. Well, this one will tell you who your neighbors are and give you names to pray about as you're getting in the process of building a relationship with them.
Yeah. Excellent. A question came here for you, Dr. Lloyd, from Nancy Liatsis. I know she's in Brooklyn.
Okay.
Was the New York initiative Pray New York, or was it something else that you were invited to?
Yeah, it was Pray New York in conjunction with NY City Serve and a number of other ministries. Pastor Dave Burdell was the leader of the group, and he's developed a website called Saturate NY, I believe is the title of it, and where their goal is to do what we're saying all along here, is we want to bathe the city in prayer.
Yeah,
he uses a verse, Habakkuk 2:14, saying that the whole earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord, even as the waters cover the sea. Mm-hmm. So that's what they want to see happen in New York. Their next meeting is on March 31st. And amazingly, I have both a New York and a Newark meeting that day. So I'll have to pray about which one to go to, because we've been asked to introduce Adopt a Cop into Newark on that day as well. So.
Okay.
Thanks happening.
Yeah. Oh, that's wonderful. That's a great problem to have as to which prayer initiative meeting to be at, right?
Exactly. And New York will be having a movement day in May, as they always do, where they give more details about this. So Nancy and others that are interested, you might want to contact your local prayer leaders about this.
That's great.
So we actually met in the Salvation Army building in Manhattan on 14th Street, which is a great place for a lot of ministries. Crew people are there, and Navigators, and Youth for Christ, and a number of other great ministries share that historic building.
That's excellent.
So, yeah, I could say a lot more about New York, but let's move on. Are there any other questions before we move on? Okay, so let's briefly talk about Bless Minnesota, and I know we have a couple Minnesota people on here, so chime in. Blessmn.org, I believe, is your website, and it's got some great tools about how to sign up cities in your state of Minnesota, and I know Greg Pogg and others have been doing a terrific job, particularly on the media area. I would say you're very media savvy. You have your own theme song for Bless Minnesota, and you really have the goal of not just the Minneapolis, St. Paul area, but the whole state being covered in prayer. So I don't know, do you, anyone from Minnesota want to chime in on that and give us a quick update?
I'm scrambling here to promote Tanya. Not sure Brent is with her here, so let's see. Let's see what happens. There we go.
There's Tanya. Hi.
There we go. We got you on here, Tanya.
Thanks. I guess all I would add to that is just, yeah, I mean, we really are hitting the media. Greg just got done now getting on two major radio stations that have ads that go on regularly. So people are, it's been in front of people a lot to really keep it in front of them, to keep people that they're not just hearing it once, but keeping them interested. Really focusing on the National Day of Prayer right now, where we're encouraging everyone to go to the highest place in their city. And speak over it, speak blessing over it. And that's really our really large push right now through the state.
And Tanya, how many initiatives do you have in Bless Minnesota at this point?
Oh, I knew you were going to ask me that, Lloyd. I'm not a numbers person. We need Greg for that. But
yeah,
he wouldn't be real proud of me right now.
I'd say it's 100 something then.
Oh, yeah. It's grown. It's actually grown quite a bit. And it's a lot of businesses, churches, which adds up to, I think it's like 700 streets in the state of Minnesota right now.
Okay. Wow.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
Okay. Well, thanks for the update, and we'll be keeping you in prayer. If there's anything we can do to help you with your initiative or others on the call, you know, please drop me a line and we'll be glad to brainstorm anytime. Okay.
That would be great. Thank you.
Okay. So if there's no more questions, let me move on to Indonesia then. I think this will really bless you. Okay, so can you see that? That Adopt a Street Indonesia, myhomeindonesia.org,
yep.
Has a Adopt a Street section, and if you type in EN, you'll get the English version rather than the Indonesian version, which is a great benefit if you only speak English. So their initiative is called Adopsi Jalan, and I'm probably massacring the pronunciation, but that means to adopt a street in Indonesia. So this is their homepage. It looks a lot like transformourworld.org. You can see, I believe that's probably Jakarta downtown. They have a about section, and they have adopt a street. And they have some great resources under media, both photos and videos. And then they have some blogs, which I think are probably only in Indonesian. Look, this map will look familiar to you if you're familiar with transformourworld.org. So far, they have 84,648 streets adopted in Indonesia. And this is just the 500 most recent. So you can see there's a big number around Jakarta. And then there's also another big one around central part, which is where Surabaya is located. Here's a list of some of the cities in Indonesia that are on My Home Indonesia, and I understand they started with 384, so this is only a partial list of the cities that are doing Adopt a Street in Indonesia. Here's a photo from one of the meetings in Surabaya, which is the number two city in Indonesia. We'll show you some more shots from Surabaya. And there's a five-minute video that's really nice. I'll give you the highlights of it here. So they say it's time to pray and stand before God for the people of Indonesia. A moment to adopt the streets where we live to be brought into prayer. And he says that to adopt means to take responsibility, to take care, and to maintain. So it's more than just putting a name on a street or praying for someone in a phone book. It's actually caring and maintaining those people. We maintain the streets and the areas where we live and work through prayer. And we don't only focus on praying, but we also build good relationships with our neighbors. And we serve as the light of God for our neighbors. So we're bringing light into a place of darkness. Now, folks, Indonesia is a little different from the United States. So you have about 10% Christians there. And I've never met a lukewarm Christian in Indonesia. Yeah, if you're a Christian, you're either going to be very fervent for the Lord and probably persecuted, or you're going to not admit it at all. So there's no point in being a lukewarm Christian in Indonesia or a lot of other countries. So you need to be the light of God in every country, but particularly in one like Indonesia, where you're a minority religion. And they believe change is going to happen. You say, okay, well and good. What does that mean? Well, if we adopt the streets where we live into prayers, because when we pray, God's kingdom come and the glory of God will fill the area. What do they expect to happen? Well, they expect to see corruption eliminated. They expect to see drugs dealt with. They expect crime to go down as they pray. And then they say that they've actually seen changes occur in several cities. And this is the most interesting part of the presentation. At the conference in San Jose last fall, Daniel sent along some copies of this wonderful book called Changing the Spiritual Climate. And I'm just going to give you a few highlights. It goes on for more than 100 slides, so just a lot of details that he's given us about what's happened there in the last 4 years. So they launched Adopt a Street at the World Prayer Assembly in Jakarta in 2012. It started with the Unity of Indonesian Christians and the meetings of the World Prayer Association. They held the World Prayer Assembly in 400 cities in Indonesia and various cities in the world in May 2012. And those 400 cities, or 384 to be exact, were the ones that started street adoption at that time. Now here's a banner. This is in the biggest stadium in Jakarta, 120,000 people raising their hands to see a streets adopted in Jakarta. I wish I had been there. I'm sure some of you would have as well. So they have 34 provinces in Indonesia, more than 300 cities, and their target for last year was to grow that to 500 cities in the My Home Indonesia movement. So you can see the whole nation of Indonesia is being impacted. In Jakarta, part of loving their neighborhood was caring for health for victims of flooding. And in Surabaya, they have what's called prayer towers. 2006, they started the prayer towers in different cities or different parts of Surabaya. And in 2009, they developed health services in 31 districts. They started cleaning sidewalks for six main roads. They cleaned the river. They planted trees for city parks. They provided assistance to the flood pumps and for the Surabaya city government. So that was just the start, and they're continuing. It sounds a lot like what Becky's going to tell us about in Johnson City, Tennessee, where multiple agencies are getting involved and the Christians along with them. Now, Surabaya was known as the largest prostitution city in all of Southeast Asia, but no longer. Since they've started My Home Indonesia, several of the prostitution places have gone out of business. And here's a list of six of them that have disappeared since My Home Indonesia started up. Borneo is another big island in Indonesia. There they're working on reconciliation between the different churches and with the government of Borneo. In Bali Island, which is a resort area, they work on providing clean water and filters. They do mentoring to the village officials and administrators. They provide generators to supply power, and they work on electricity substations, which couldn't be used for years because of technical problems. Now the Christians are coming in and helping with all those. And here's an example of a reverse osmosis system that they put in one of the towns in Trunyan in Bali Island. So that's just part of it. And let me stop at this point and ask if you have questions about anything I've shared with you from My Home Indonesia.
is tremendous, Lloyd. It really is. It's to think they launched it in a stadium with 120,000 people and you know, immediately had folks in 340 cities. That's a pretty great small beginning.
Yeah, now they're looking for actually for 1 million intercessors to pray for the streets of Indonesia in coming years as well. And up to 1,000 cities they want to see eventually involved across Indonesia.
Praise God.
So you can see what they've done is they've made Adopt-A-Street part of a broader platform for Christian involvement in the communities in Indonesia.
Yeah, I was just going to say, you can see, I mean, just on those, on the more recent slides there, the, you know, they're praying, but they're acting. They're taking action as well in a real practical way, meeting the people's felt needs, helping the flood victims and others. And I think, boy, those two just go hand in hand. The more we pray, the more God changes our hearts and gets our hands and feet ready to move. And you know, we get in there and roll up our sleeves and I know when you really adopt something, when you really adopt your street and your neighbors, it just goes beyond the prayer, right? It's easy. The easy part can be just at your home praying for them, or even getting out and prayer walking. But man, it's a whole lot more inconvenient when a neighbor starts showing up on your doorstep in the middle of the night asking for help, or you know, you find yourself having to be inconvenienced to reach out. But that's what we need to do. That's part of the whole process. And we're seeing that and on such a large scale there in Indonesia. But just some of my personal reflections for everybody as we're watching this is that, you know, God will, the more that we pray for our neighborhood and our spheres of influence, the more God will change our hearts and move us to action, move us. They really go hand in hand. You really can't have one without the other. So.
Yes, I would urge you to go on to the My Home Indonesia website and just spend about 20 or 30 minutes watching some of the clips and photos there and getting a sense of how this Adopt-A-Street can relate to the broader transformation movement story. But they don't distinguish between prayer and transformation. They see one leading naturally to the other.
Absolutely. Yes. Absolutely. Great. If anybody has a question or a comment, go ahead and stick it there in the chat box. And any reflections from you, Dr. Lisa?
I want to say the word adoption is so strong. And when I think of adoption, I think of if you could literally, you know, place yourself in adopting the child, to give you a visual image. How would you adopt that child? How would you care for that child? How would you take on that child as your own and nurture and love that child? And it's the same concept, you know, loving the city, praying for the city, loving the people and demonstrating God's love and offering hope.
Absolutely. Amen. Well said. Absolutely.
Okay. So we have this thing called the Global Canopy of Prayer Evangelism that I wanted to mention as well, that Harvest Evangelism and ITN have been involved in. And more recently, they have a connection with Dick Eastman's ministry and Dutch Sheets, Cindy Jacobs, Lou Engel, a number of other national prayer movements, National Day of Prayer with Paul Cedars. That are praying to see spiritual change in the climate in America. So there'll be a 40-day period right after Easter. There'll be another 40-day prayer movement leading up to the elections in November. So we really need to go to the Lord and pray about how to change the spiritual climate of America, particularly in this critical election year. So, we have about 15 minutes left for questions and answers. Let me plant a couple seeds for next week while you're thinking of additional questions for us. So next week, I'll have a general discussion of Adopt-A-Cop. And I want to share with you some data and some insights from the Washington Post, which did a national survey last year of everyone that was shot by a policeman in the United States. And accompanying that, Becky Haas has some data on the reverse side of the coin, which is policemen that were shot or killed in the line of duty. So that goes right along with it. So the questions for next time that I have for you are three. Number one, what are the spiritual roots of police violence in America. We'll talk a little bit about the history of it and how Black Lives Matter came up and how it's related to earlier movements such as the Black Panthers. But the question for us as intercessors and as pastors is, what are the spiritual roots of the violence? Second question I have for you, what are the concrete policy changes that the Black Lives Matter movement would like to see promoted? And thirdly, what are the, and this is the most important one for us, is what are the spiritual issues that intercessors need to pray for to support government initiatives to reduce police and citizen violence? And I know we'll have a great dialogue on that because Becky's our resident expert on that. And I know, Dr. Lisa, you may want to join us. And we'll be having Anthony Summers on the last session, which is on April 12th. He'll be talking about both Adopt a Street and Adopt a Cop as they've implemented them in Vallejo, California. Mm-hmm. So those are our questions for next time. Let me turn it back to Benji and ask, do we have any additional comments or questions as we draw this session to a close?
Yeah, I was I was just prompted here to share a personal example from kind of our story in our neighborhood. And this goes back a few years back now when we first moved into our current neighborhood. We were immediately kind of warned by other neighbors about some of the other neighbors. So they came over to us and said, hey, listen, we see that you have small kids. Watch out for these people over this way because there's a lot of drug trafficking and you know, teenage gang activity and stuff that happens where the police get called on a weekly basis. Just be aware of that. So we say, okay, thank you. Nice to be welcome to the neighborhood. And immediately our hearts just went out to them and we just said, you know, that gives us a great cue for us to pray and to begin to really speak peace and to trust the Lord to see the spiritual climate change. And so we just began to do that persistently. Every night as a family, we'd specifically kind of face that direction and reach our hands out and pray and speak peace and blessings when we'd be out walking, heading to the park or wherever with the kids, you know, passing past the house there, speaking peace and blessings as well. And I just began to actually engage one of the young guys there and playing basketball, and we'd get out and play a couple times a week and just kind of built a relationship. And fast forward the story a little bit, several months later, we got a knock on the door. We were just sitting down to eat dinner, and three of the kids from that house were on our doorstep, soaking wet and shivering and cold and hungry and saying, can you help us?
Wow.
So these were kids that we had been warned to not engage, to not be there. And me being a good father, having two young ones at the time, going, what do we do here? So I look over to my wife to see if she has a cue to give me. And she says, invite them in. Get them inside here. So we invite them in and add a little more water to the soup and sit down and have a meal with them. And just start hearing about their lives and the brokenness that was there and some of the issues and the challenges that they've gone through and the difficulty. And it just literally broke our hearts to hear that none of them could remember sitting at a table having a meal together as a family. Not one of the three kids could even remember having that. And they just felt such warmth sitting around our table sharing a meal with us. Well, I'll fast forward the story a little bit, and that night we were able to lead all three of those kids to the Lord.
Oh, wow.
So this house immediately began to change from being a huge activity base for drug trafficking and all of that to changing it to literally a week later. It was kind of funny because it's kind of right across the street from us, but the people that would come and use drugs would throw their needles and stuff on our yard. And, you know, and there was always kind of drug paraphernalia kind of on our side yard and stuff. And these kids that we had led to the Lord started kind of cleaning up the neighborhood and telling the others, saying, hey, listen, if you're going to do drugs, don't go over there. That's our pastor's house. And I don't want you anywhere near there. And I don't want you, You know, I don't want you putting litter on their street or on their yard or anything like that. They got young kids. You shouldn't be doing that anyways, you know. So it was really amazing. It was, you know, I'm really condensing the story here for the sake of time, but it was an ongoing long-term process that we're still seeing, you know, in process today. But just the power of speaking peace and blessings. And just to echo what you were saying there, Dr. Lisa, about really adopting the kids. And I can tell you, man, every protective instinct inside of me as a husband and as a father was on high alert when I opened the door and I see these three particular teenagers standing on my doorstep and they want to come into my house. I'm like, you know, man, that was a moment of crossing a threshold. And, you know, as it turns out, the Lord just used it so much for good. So we've seen some incredible things take place as we've taken ownership, spiritual ownership of our neighborhood and just say, hey, listen, not on our watch, you know, not on our watch in this neighborhood are we going to see these things happen. And having that personal ownership really makes a difference. And then, of course, trusting the Lord, you know, but every prayer that we pray is powerful. Every word of blessing, every time we speak peace, it really does help shift that spiritual climate. And my personal belief is that we would have never seen those kids on our doorstep had we not been first taking our other well-meaning neighbors' advice and say, don't, you know, stay away from those people, be aware they're problematic, all of that. Had we taken their advice, we probably would have never seen what we've seen happen. So I just encourage you, you know, where there's a need, where there's felt needs, where there's a problem issue, boy, it's a great place to begin to target your prayers and to really go for it.
Yeah, thank you for sharing that story. That's a great story, Benji. That reminds me of a story from Dr. Gloria Harris, who has been to a few of the Harvest Evangelism conferences we had in Hawaii. And she is in a tough neighborhood in Newark where there's two gangs that are competing for territory. One of them is the Bloods and the other one's the Crips. Mm-hmm. And sometimes they get a little rowdy. And so during the service, she'll just go out there and ask the guys if they would please move down. And they respect her because she loves and cares for them. So they take their differences and move down the street and talk about them.
Wow.
And then her grandson actually was looking for some money. So he started mowing lawns a couple years ago. And he mowed a couple lawns on the avenue by their church. And the people from the neighborhood started doing likewise because they saw that trimming the shrubs and mowing the lawns made the street look a lot prettier. So we've just had some great stories about how little things even will change the spiritual climate of your neighborhood.
Yeah, amen. That's awesome. That's awesome.
I wanted to add a bit also about the New York movement that I went to last week. As you know, the Pray for Newark movement came out of concerns about violence and public safety, mostly, in the 2007 timeframe. But New York City has had a history of Pray for Jesus movements for maybe 20 years. And some of you who have been in Harvest for a while will know Pastor Roger McPhail, who actually organized some of the March for Jesus movements in Brooklyn and maybe other boroughs as well. Well, the most recent thrust with Pastor Dave Bidell is in response to Hurricane Sandy. And Lisa, you had mentioned coming out here during that time, but what happened in Staten Island really got the brunt of the hurricane, and the churches had to start working together. A lot of them didn't even know each other at the time, but because of the crisis and the fact that it didn't go away, they were forced to work together in new and supernatural ways. So I would say that the thrust now for mobilizing New York for prayer is coming out of Staten Island, and particularly out of those churches that prayed together to get through the homelessness and the devastation that Hurricane Sandy brought.
Amen, amen. And that is Roger McPhail that you mentioned, Lloyd. That's Nancy Liatsis's pastor, which I think you're aware of.
Okay.
Maybe you weren't aware, but everybody, we know who Roger McPhail is, and we know his chief intercessor, Nancy Liatsis, part of this course here. So
excellent. Well,
thank you for that little prompt.
I know the New York people are wanting to connect with Roger and your team and see what God has in store for New York. And if we can add some fuel to the fire with the tools we have at transformourworld.org, then so be it.
That's awesome. I don't see any other questions here, Lloyd. So maybe you want to just bring it to a close and we can.
Okay. So again, thanks to everyone, particularly to Dr. Lisa Fuller-Tweh, who's going to close us in a minute. Thank you for Becky Haas, and thank you for all of us that are joining us. And please join at the same time next week and send me your questions, and we'll go through those as well. So I'm going to sign off and ask Lisa to close us.
Amen. Thank you. Father God, we come to you humble in the name of Jesus, Lord. We just ask you, oh God, in the name of Jesus, just to move and have your way, oh God. We plead the blood of Jesus over every street, oh God, every nation, oh God, every home, oh God, every man, every child, every woman, oh God, in the name of Jesus. I ask you, oh God, in the name of Jesus, for impartation, oh God. I ask you, oh God, in the name of Jesus, just to give strategies, oh God, heart and a burden, oh God, for adoption, oh God, Indonesia, oh God, help them to reach the intercessors, oh God, give them divine appointments, oh God. Father God, in Minnesota, oh God, touch the whole state, oh God, cover them with the blood of Jesus and impart into them, oh God. I ask you to cover New York City, oh God. Give them, oh God, in the name of Jesus, a blessing for the whole state, oh God. Let them be a demonstration of your glory, oh God. Father God, in the name of Jesus, touch Newark, oh God, and touch everyone, oh God, in the name of Jesus, that is affiliated with Harvest, oh God, for Dr. Street, oh God, for Dr. Cop, oh God. Cover the police, oh God, with the blood of Jesus and keep them safe, oh God. Cover the people as they walk in the streets, oh God, for prayer walks, oh God, in the name of Jesus. And I ask you, oh God, to move and have your way. Have your divine way, oh God. Give them a hunger for your people. Give them a hunger, oh God, and a desire to love the things that you love and hate the things that you hate, oh God. Lord, we speak these blessings, oh God. We speak peace. We speak impartation. We speak newness. We speak revival, oh God, in the name of Jesus. And it is so. Amen.
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 Thanks, everyone, for joining. It's been a great session, and I'm sure that you'll have lots of comments and questions for next time.
All right. Thank you, everybody. Everybody, God bless you. We'll see you next Tuesday, March the 29th for session 4. And I look forward to seeing and connecting everybody then. God bless you all.
God bless you.